The next item of business is a statement by Neil Gray on Health and Social Care Winter Preparedness Plan 2024 to 2025. The Cabinet Secretary will take questions at the end of his statement, and so there should be no interventions or interruptions. And I call on Neil Gray, up to 10 minutes, Cabinet Secretary.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Our health and social care services provide essential support for people throughout the year. The nature of the demand that they face can shift in the winter months when we can see an increase in respiratory and weather-related illnesses. That's why, with COSLA, we are today publishing the Health and Social Care Winter Preparedness Plan for 24-25. I would like to take this opportunity to offer my thanks to all those across the NHS and social care, including independent, third and voluntary sectors, who support and deliver this work. The NHS and the social care sector plans for winter on an annual basis. After all, winter follows autumn each year is far from a surprise. But that's why investment to plan for winter is now baselined into NHS board budgets at the start of the financial year. The Scottish Government continues to prioritise investment in frontline services, with over £14.2 billion invested in our NHS boards, with additional funding of over £500 million on an almost 3% real terms uplift. The 2024-25 Scottish Budget also provided over £2 billion for social care support. This means that social care spending has increased by over £1 billion compared to 21-22, doubling our investment in Scotland's care and delivering early on our commitment to increase spending by 25% to over £840 million over the life of the Parliament. However, what is really important and what this plan is about is people. Patients and service users are the very reason our health and social care services exist. This is only made possible by our dedicated workforces that are at the heart of the excellent care they provide. I want to put on record my thanks to the Agenda for Change unions for agreeing to this year's pay deal, which sees staff get a 5.5% increase and ensures that Scotland's nurses and other Agenda for Change staff are the best paid anywhere in the UK. The principles that underpin the plan retain our focus on the individual. We have set these out in our four winter planning priorities that follow a journey through the health and social care system. Firstly, we will prioritise care for people in our communities, enabling them to live well with the support they choose, utilising effective prevention to keep people well, avoiding the need for hospital care. By reducing the chance that people need admission into an acute hospital setting, we not only improve people's individual health and well-being, but reduce overall demand, protecting our hospital services from being overwhelmed. And this prevention and early intervention approach starts by keeping people well in our communities and supporting them to live happy, healthy and independent lives for as long as possible. Whilst our first priority is about preventing people needing additional care in the first place, our second priority is about ensuring that when they do need support, they receive care that is right for them in the right place at the right time. We know that people see better outcomes when they receive care at home or as close as home to possible as possible, where clinically appropriate. And our third priority ensures that our integrated health and social care services maximise capacity to meet demand, effectively managing surge pressures. This is a key element of our mission to reduce delayed discharge, which increases capacity by ensuring people do not remain in hospital longer than is clinically appropriate. Additionally, it is crucial that planned and established care services are protected, working to reduce long waits and address unmet needs. Putting people at the centre of our plan is not only about those who use our services. Therefore, our fourth priority focuses on supporting the well-being of our health and social care workforce, their capacity and improving retention, as well as recognising and supporting Scotland's unpaid carers. Presiding Officer, these priorities run throughout our plan to ensure that all the actions within it are part of a cohesive, whole-system approach with people as the focus. The plan itself sets out these actions in more detail. For example, we will support the provision of excellent care for individuals in their own homes through dedicated care at home services. £124 million of additional funding has been allocated to enhance care at home capacity, as well as £3.6 million to support the growth of hospital at home services. Services like these provide tailored care to the needs of almost 90,000 people across Scotland, enabling people to live as independently as possible in their own homes. And for those living in care homes, we continue to provide £14 million of funding for NHS boards to enable enhanced support for care in care homes. This has ensured and helped to ensure the right care for residents to avoid admission to hospital and timely discharge from hospital. We know that providing the right care in the right setting, including through hospital at home, has prevented over 10,000 older people from spending time in hospital during April to December 2023, relieving pressure from accident and emergency and the Scottish Ambulance Service, and critically, improving patient outcomes. All of these efforts, therefore, go towards helping to develop further resilience in our health and social care system, recognising that demand is not static. Solidifying our efforts towards the right services at the right time, we are supporting the primary care system to be as resilient as possible heading into winter. A fundamental part of this is ensuring that people are able to access the care they need within their community where appropriate. One such example is the Scottish Ambulance Service's integrated clinical hub, which helps to direct patients to the most appropriate point of care without automatically directing them to accident and emergency. We're also supporting health boards to make necessary changes to drive forward improvement and implementation of key actions, including a focusing on increasing alternatives to hospital attendance, focusing on reducing length of stay over 14 days for non-delayed patients, and increasing short stays less than 72 hours to improve occupancy and flow. We continue to invest in NHS 24 to bolster capacity, providing the highest level of call handlers on record for the service, and continuing to increase clinical staff, making the service more efficient for users. This investment has enabled NHS 24 to expand recruitment opportunities in a number of local areas, such as Ayrshire and Arran, Inverness and Dumfries and Galloway. These staff will give the organisation capacity to provide clinical supervision to at least 150,000 additional calls per year, in turn preventing people from unnecessarily attending accident emergency. This also provides NHS 24 with the additional flexibility and capacity to deal with public holidays, improving service performance on these days. Our hospitals provide specialist, high-quality, safe clinical care, where nearly 97% of people are discharged without delay. Unfortunately, some remain in hospital longer than clinically necessary. To address this, we are continuing to take action to embed good practice for discharge processes and, where necessary, continuing to challenge poor performance. This includes improving effective discharge planning for patients admitted to acute or community hospitals, protecting established care at home packages, allowing discharge without further delay for assessment. And we are also offering direct support to systems through a government-led response team to support those areas struggling. It is vital, Presiding Officer, that we involve people and their carers in decisions that relate to their care to enhance choice and control over their support. In hospital, this means engaging the patient, their family and any carers in hospital discharge discussions to ensure their needs and wants are central to decision-making. This will be supported using home-based assessments such as discharge to assess for all home support packages to ensure accurate person-centred assessments in familiar homely environments. Crucially, it is important to note that tackling delayed discharge is not just a health issue. It is a whole system issue and fundamentally about making sure people are receiving the right care in the right place. While it is also fundamental that we support and safeguard the well-being of our health and social care workforce throughout the year, it is particularly vital during periods of increased demand, which may put additional pressure on staff. National supporting work-life balance workforce policies offer NHS staff a variety of flexible working options. These options support staff in achieving a healthy work-life balance while continuing to deliver and promote the highest standard of care to our patients and service users. We're also collaborating with NHS boards to promote part-time work opportunities for health, social care and social work students. We must also ensure that people who provide unpaid care are supported in their caring roles. This means ensuring carers are supported to look after their own health and well-being alongside engaging in education, training or employment. We're implementing our national carer strategy to drive forward long-term changes to improve the lives of unpaid carers across Scotland. Presiding Officer, the plan published today will help our health and social care services to prepare for the challenges that may lie ahead over the coming winter months, recognising that we can never be totally certain how many additional people this year may suffer from respiratory viruses such as flu or COVID, or the extent to which bad winter weather may impact on accident and falls. So whilst this plan helps us to prepare as best we can, there is always the risk that extreme events overwhelm the available capacity in the system. However, as we have seen in other extreme events, such as COVID, if our preparation is not enough to cope with the exceptional surges of demand, we stand prepared to deploy more significant in extremis interventions in partnership with COSLA and the health and social care sector. So in closing, Presiding Officer, I would like once again to thank all the people across our health and social care system who help turn the actions set out in this plan into the reality of services which support and care for the people of Scotland. And the Scottish Government and our partners in COSLA are united in our drive to provide person-centred, safe and timely health and social care services for our people, not only over winter, but all year long.
Thank you. The Cabinet Secretary will now take questions on the issues raised in his statement. I intend to allow around 20 minutes for questions, after which we'll move on to the next item of business. I'd be grateful if members who wish to put a question were to press their request to speak buttons. And I call on Sandesh Gulhani.
A declaration of interest as a practising NHS GP. There is nothing new here. Everything is rehashed and the spin is dizzying. Summer A&E waiting times are basically the same as winter waiting times. There is no credible plan here to address winter pressure. After 17 years of SNP failure, this is the ultimate show of giving up and going through the motions. 2 hours in this chamber to debate independence, 2 hours in this chamber to debate UK budget, both of which we have nothing to do with in this Parliament, but only 20 minutes to question this lack of a plan to save lives this winter. I am terrified at what winter will bring. Patients in corridors and ambulances queued out of the block. The Cabinet Secretary's lack of a credible plan will mean patient safety compromised, staff safety compromised, and staff mental health compromised. Will the Cabinet Secretary agree to the recording and reporting of incidences where patients are cared for in inappropriate areas such as corridors and treatment rooms, or when additional beds are added to wards without the necessary staffing or equipment to ensure patient and staff safety and dignity?
Cabinet Secretary.
Thank you very much, Presiding Officer, and I thank Sandesh Gulhani for his questions and observations. The first thing that I would say is that the resourcing of our health services is directly linked to the decisions that are taken at a UK government level. So I think it's right that we have discussions and debates around those issues that he raises, as well as the opportunity to interrogate the winter preparedness plan that I have set out. He says that there is nothing new in this plan. That is because we are seeking to provide consistency to systems in order to address the issues that they are facing. That is an ask that has been made directly to us. We are seeking to provide that consistency. We know what works, and that is why we have this plan. In terms of the wider points that he raises, I recognise that there are challenges within many of our accident emergency services, many of our wards, where we are seeing pressures upon the system. That's why I reference so explicitly the work that's been done to address delayed discharge. And I'd be more than happy to provide further information around the work to reduce the pressure that there are on acute hospital services and the points you raised about corridor care as well.
Carol Mockin.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. And can I thank the Cabinet Secretary for advance sight of his statement. The reality for our staff and communities is winter pressures are now all year round. And I want to focus on delayed discharge. I need to use figures, but can we remember that this is real people and their families whose lives are on hold? The last monthly data for July, which is the middle of summer, it revealed that an average of 1,900 bed days were occupied due to delayed discharge. There were 61,165 total bed days lost, which is the highest month ever. Now, the government talks up its joint plan with local government, but this includes no new money and it's just not sustainable. So can the Cabinet Secretary confirm what it will take for this government to take some clear action on this point in particular?
Cabinet Secretary.
I thank Carol Mockin for her questions, and I recognise the point that she makes around the pressures within our health service been all year round. I'd reference the fact that we still have a huge pressure coming from COVID within the system. The peak that we saw was over 600 beds being used for COVID in July this year. That's the equivalent of Wishaw General Hospital being utilised for COVID. So it serves to illustrate the year-round pressure we have, which is why this is a year-round plan. It's a surge plan rather than just purely a winter plan, and one that we are providing on a funded basis, on a baseline basis for boards to plan on a year-round basis. She's right also to point to delayed discharge being an issue. That's not a Scottish-only phenomenon, as Carol Mochan will know. The comparative figures that we're able to draw for Wales shows that there is around 60 adults per 100,000 in Wales on delay compared to 44 in Scotland. Now, I don't say that as this is a position that we should be comfortable with. Of course we're not, but it serves to illustrate the shared pressures that there are upon our whole system, both health and social care, that are shared in Scotland and Wales, and why it's so important that we see an increase in investment in health and social care from the UK Government, so that both the Welsh Government and the Scottish Government can respond accordingly to support health and social care services as a result.
Claire Haughey, to be followed by Tess White.
Thank you, Presiding Officer, and I refer members to my register of interests. I hold a bank nurse contract with Greater Glasgow and Clyde NHS. Freeing up capacity in our NHS is crucial as we head towards a period of higher demand. Can the Cabinet Secretary outline what work will be undertaken to improve patient flow and tackle delayed discharge? And can he say how the efficacy of those interventions will be measured?
Cabinet Secretary.
I thank Claire Haughey for that question. I want to reiterate what I set out in my statement, that this must be seen as a whole system issue, and as we seek to tackle it, recognise that it's about having people receiving the care that they need in the right place. Improving accident and emergency performance, enhancing patient flow in our acute hospitals and reducing the number of people being held in hospital unnecessarily continue to be top priorities for this government. The vast majority, nearly 97% of people, are discharged without delay, but the delayed discharge figure is still far too high. Some people remain in hospital after it is clinically necessary, which can result in poorer outcomes for them and additional pressure on the system, including on hospital flow, particularly during the winter. So through our improvement programme, significant work has been undertaken with NHS health boards over the last year to identify ways to create capacity in the system, resulting in lower occupancy for people and increased flow. Ensuring that every patient has an effective discharge date, agreed through multidisciplinary working to avoid being delayed in hospital once clinically fit for discharge. And finally, we're working closely with COSLA and national and local leaders to support improvement, such as the Discharge Without Delay programme, offer direct support to systems through a government-led response team to support those areas that are struggling to meet delayed discharge targets. Having system leaders across health and social care working closely with national improvement teams is essential to jointly implement and deliver sustainable improvements.
Tess White, to be followed by Emma Harper.
Cabinet Secretary, when she was Health Secretary, Shona Robison promised to eradicate delayed discharge, and it was a commitment she reiterated last year at First Minister's Questions. Last financial year, there were 666,190 days spent in hospital because of delayed discharge, the highest annual figure reported. And the statement only mentions reducing delayed discharge. The question is, when will this SNP government stop papering over the cracks and give primary care, particularly GP practices in relation to the 2018 contract, the support it needs?
Cabinet Secretary.
So I agree with Tess White that we need to do more in regards to delayed discharge. I've set that out both in response to Carol Mochan and in my statement in itself, that we need to do more and that we're seeing a situation where we have too many people on delay in our hospitals. That is bad for them, but it's also bad for our health and social care systems. We are making progress in terms of the implementation of the GP contract. We have made particular improvements and enhancements around the multidisciplinary team support that is available for GP practices, and I continue to engage with the GP committee of the BMA as well as the Royal College of GPs around how we can go further.
Emma Harper, to be followed by Rhoda Grant.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Last week I met the new Chief Exec of NHS Borders, and one of the areas he suggested we must address and which could provide additional capacity within the NHS for the winter months is to streamline medical assessment process and better implement the re-ablement model to help address delayed discharge. Can the Cabinet Secretary provide an update on the work to achieve these aims?
Cabinet Secretary.
Thank you, President Officer, and I thank Emma Harper. Yes, we can. We're working with NHS boards through our Urgent and Unscheduled Care Collaborative to support the implementation of a range of measures to improve processes, increase out-of-hospital-based capacity and drive down accident emergency waiting times. A key part of this work is to epitomise assessment and care in our EDs by improving access to same-day services, the use of early and effective triage, rapid decision-making and streamlining to assessment areas. So, in addition to that, the Collaborative Response and Assurance Oversight Group is working to identify and promote good practice that supports system flow. This includes national improvement work to look at system-wide issues and targeted local engagement to support areas facing particular challenge to improve their processes and models. And I've seen for myself much of this innovation, including the work in the Borders, which is to be commended.
To Grant, to be followed by Ruth McGuire.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. This statement does not mention rural healthcare once, and yet the Cabinet Secretary knows that delivering on the four winter planning priorities is more challenging in rural areas where travel, weather and unfilled vacancies add to the chaos. In Highland, elderly and disabled people have often been asked to travel 50 to 100 miles to access their COVID and flu vaccinations because their GP practices are no longer allowed to deliver these. And as a consequence, vaccine numbers are falling, and this is definitely not keeping people well. Can I ask what steps he's taken to ensure that frail elderly people access vaccination at home or as near as home, to home as possible in order that they're protected this winter?
Cabinet Secretary.
Thank you, President Officer. And I thank Rhoda Grant for her question. I recognise, as somebody who grew up in Orkney, the challenge that there is in delivering health and social care services in rural and island communities, which is part of the reason why I have to contradict Rhoda Grant in regards to the ability of Highland, NHS Highland, to be able to deliver vaccinations through GPs, because there is a flexibility within the contract that allows for that to happen, and I've given a very clear steer to NHS Highland, because of the difficulties that they've had with their vaccination programme, to be able to deliver it through their GPs if that is the best route to do it. That is happening in some parts of Highland, and as a result we are seeing an improvement in the vaccination perspective, but it's not true to say that they cannot, it's just that they need to make sure that there is a clear reason as to be able to deliver it through the GPs.
Ruth McGuire, to be followed by Gillian Mackay.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Ensuring people's homes are promptly adapted to meet their needs is a crucial part of avoiding unnecessary hospital stays. I have a number of cases where constituents have been let down and discharged to home environments that did not offer them dignity in regards to their personal hygiene needs and safe mobility. I think we intuitively can understand the negative impact that would have on their rehabilitation and that it might even cause readmission to hospital. What action will the Scottish Government take to ensure that NHS, local authorities and housing associations fulfil their obligations to my constituents in that regard?
Cabinet Secretary.
Thank you, President Officer. I thank Ruth McGuire for raising this, and I absolutely agree with her on the need to make sure we make progress here. Anyone requiring adaptations to their home should experience a smooth transition through the pathway of care, which ensures that they receive the right intervention at the right time, and it's critically important that people are supported to live safely in their home environment, as this can epitomise health, avoid admittance to hospital, reduce falls and support effective discharge home. So in January 2023, we published revised guidance on the provision of equipment and adaptations. The overall aim of this guidance is to deliver a more equitable and accessible approach to the provision of adaptations, and we're also working closely with the NHS and local authorities who have delivery responsibility to evaluate whether those local practices are in line with the Scottish Government's guidance and deliver the services improvements and influence future policy development exactly so we can meet the needs of Ruth McGuire's constituents.
Gillian Mackay, to be followed by Christine Graham.
Thanks, Presiding Officer. The Cabinet Secretary mentioned opening up work opportunities for students. And while some of this will be welcome experience, we need to ensure their studies are not impacted and that their eagerness to help is not exploited. Can the Cabinet Secretary outline what band these students will be employed on, whether they will be employed on zero-hour contracts, and if there will be oversight of how many shifts these students are picking up to ensure that no one is being overworked?
Cabinet Secretary.
Thank you. I'll respond in more detail to Gillian McCagg, because I don't have all of that detail in front of me. But obviously the work that we do here will be in line with the Government's established Fair Work principles. But I'll make sure I get a fuller response to Gillian McKay on the points that she raises.
Christine Graham, to be followed by Alex Cole-Hamilton.
Thank you very much, Presiding Officer. Of course, it's essential that we focus on the individual. And the Cabinet Secretary, as we will remember, visited the Borders General Hospital with me recently to learn about hospital at home, and the clue is in the name, with at that time 16 patients opting for this, freeing 16 beds and over 90% patient satisfaction, mainly elderly people. Can I therefore ask the Cabinet Secretary if this can be rolled out further to increase this option?
Secretary.
Thank you, President Officer. I thank Christine Graham for her question and reminding me of the excellent visit that we undertook in her constituency, looking at the funding that the Government was releasing to ensure that it was an expansion of hospital at home services. And I thank again the team in the Borders that are working so hard on this. The Scottish Government has continued to invest in the development of its hospital at home programme, which in recent years has expanded into additional pathways such as OPAT, respiratory, and more recently into heart failure and paediatric services. In particular, the Older People's Programme has delivered 495 older people or acute beds across Scotland in the last year alone, 58% above the previous year, and treated almost 14,500 patients, making it the largest provider of geriatric beds in Scotland and the country's 12th largest hospital. By increasing hospital at home capacity, we've been able to directly impact pressures on our hospitals, as well as reducing the demand on the Scottish Ambulance Service, improving patient satisfaction. So as an admission alternative, hospital at home also avoids the creation of delayed discharges and enables significant financial savings. And this year, the £3.6 million that has already been provided to 13 boards to establish new services for older people and increase the maturity and efficiency of the 20 or so services already in operation across the country. And that has enabled more areas than ever to either have a hospital at home service, but also demonstrates that the Scottish Government is committed to hospital at home, and it is a top priority for us here in Scotland.
Alex Cole-Hamilton, to be followed by Sue Webber.
Thank you very much, Presiding Officer. Presiding Officer, last week it was reported that another care home in the Highlands is set to close in Fort William with the loss of 39 care spaces. At the moment, nobody seems to have an answer as to what happens next, but it is highly likely that some of those residents will be transferred to hospitals, impacting on that health board's ability to prepare for winter. The loss perhaps is as many as 20 care homes within Highland Council over the last decade is forcing people to leave their communities for care placements that can be as much as 100 miles away, with delayed discharges already through the roof. Does the Health Secretary agree that the extra challenges of delivering care in remote and rural health areas, particularly during winter, and the journey times, the cost of care, attracting staff, mean that the care crisis is only going to compound the efforts to prepare for winter, and what is his plan to fix it?
Cabinet Secretary.
Thank you. I accept the premise of Alec Cole-Hamilton's question that difficulties that there are within some parts of the care sector obviously have an impact, not just on the individual, which is at the heart of everything that we do, but also on the health services as a result, which is why we've been doing the work with COSLA on a weekly basis with the CRAG to try to address the delayed discharge issue that we're facing. And it's true to say that there are some common issues within there, but predominantly, because we are able to see variation from partnerships within the same health board area, we know that these are local issues as well, and we're working through, as I'd said in the statement, providing support there. Alec Cole-Hamilton references the situation with HC1 in Fort William as well as in Stornoway, and we're aware of this. We're working with NHS Highland and with NHS Western Isles around looking at resilience options and what might be possible with those homes, and I'll revert to them in due course.
Sue Webber, to be followed by Rona Mackay.
Cabinet Secretary, health and social care is a disgrace. Those are the words of my constituent, Eric Drummond, who called me in a state of distress yesterday. He's largely housebound and has issues with his prostate, and they've left him incontinent. We heard today about putting people at the centre of the plan. When they do need support, they receive care that is right for them, in the right place, at the right time.
Yet Mr Drummond will have to wait 16 weeks for a nurse specialist to visit him. Cabinet Secretary, how will this plan deal with the challenges ahead when the health service isn't prepared for tomorrow, let alone winter?
Cabinet Secretary.
Thank you very much. I thank Sue Webber for raising Eric Drummond's case. And if Sue Webber wishes to pass on the details of Mr Drummond's case, I'd be more than happy to look at it and see what other intervention or support might be available. But I set out in the statement the work that we are doing and what's involved in the plan, as well as the investments that we are making to reduce the pressure on our health and social care systems. I don't think it's unique to Scotland that we have a situation where we have increased demand, increased complexity and waiting times within our health service. As regrettable as it is for me, of course it is, I want to see the best performing health service come forward. But the fact that we have common pressures resulting from the pandemic, the ongoing issues regarding continued austerity, means that those issues are common to all of us and are becoming more challenging to address.
Rona Mackay.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I'm sure many across the Chamber will recognise the brutal impact which cold weather can have on our elderly population. Can the Cabinet Secretary outline the Scottish Government's assessment of how the Labour UK Government's cruel decision to cut the winter fuel payment from 860,000 Scottish pensioners will impact not only on the health of our elderly, but also the capacity of health services up and down the country?
Cabinet Secretary.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Rona Mackay raises a very important issue that's pertinent to thousands of people across Scotland this winter. If people can't keep warm at home in the winter, then they're at increased risk of ill health, which can put additional pressure on our health and social care services. The UK Government's decision to restrict eligibility for winter fuel payments, taken without any consultation with the Scottish Government, will have a devastating impact in Scotland, removing entitlement from around 900,000 pensioners, just as Ofgem warn bills will go up by 10% this winter, thanks to the UK Government failing to intervene, thus breaking a pre-election promise twice with regards to pensioners. So the Scottish Government is committed to tackling fuel poverty, has consistently supported vulnerable households through a range of actions, including delivering our winter heating payment, which, in contrast to the UK Government's cold weather payment, guarantees a reliable annual payment of £58.75 to people on low incomes, including those pensioners in receipt of pension credit each winter.
Thank you. That concludes the ministerial statement on health and social care. I'll allow a moment or two for front benches to organise before we move on to the next item of business.